we'll be hearing from Pastor Jack, who will be leading us through the next sermon on our series on Colossians. If there are any visitors here with us today, I'd like to extend a special welcome to you. Whether you are just here on a visit or searching for a place of worship, we are absolutely delighted to have you here. It is our prayer that you will join us to live, love, and share in Christ. The bathroom, should you need them, back room towards the main entrance and down the hall to the left. If you have children, you're welcome to drop them off in our creche or Sunday school. Just head to the back of the auditorium and take a left. Process through the doors on the left, and Sunday school is located in the cafe. To limit the numbers, both creche and Sunday school start immediately with the start of the service, and as with past weeks, there will be no kids talk or kids song this week. Now we're going to start this morning's service by introducing a new song called Blessed Assurance. Before we do, I'd like to take a second to think about what we can be sure of. 2020 has been an interesting year so far. If nothing else, it is obvious that certainty is not easy to come by. In January, we were concerned about the devastation wrought by bushfires across the nation. And then our lives were turned upside down and collectively shaken by the unimaginable, unprecedented phenomenon that is the COVID-19 pandemic. To top it off, one morning a couple of weeks ago, I was building a large snowman in my front garden. 2020 has been unpredictable. 2020 has been a reminder that we are not in control. 2020 has reminded us that we cannot be sure of much. But that's okay, because Jesus offers us a blessed assurance, something unshakable. In John 10:27, Jesus says, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." So you can see that nothing else matters. We do not need to be concerned about our uncertainty about tomorrow. We can be comforted, knowing that if we follow God, nothing can snatch us from his hand. So what will happen now is we'll remain seated as we listen to the music team play Blessed Assurance, so that we can all get to know it. Make sure you pay attention, because later on in the service, after the sermon, we'll all sing it together as a congregation. After the musicians play the new song, we'll all stand together as a congregation, and we'll sing Yours Be the Glory.
Thank you.
Today's offering will be held for the Vanderwells family, who are serving as missionaries to the fortress people of India. Simon and Lydia need our support to live, but also to continue in their gospel ministry. As has become the norm, we won't be passing the bags around for hygiene reasons. Giving to the Vanderwells can easily be done electronically using the details on the screen behind me. Or if you'd like to give cash, there is a box in the foyer for that purpose. A couple of weeks ago, we were hoping to watch a short video titled, What is Organic Outreach? Unfortunately, that video didn't work. We've been having issues again this morning, but we're going to try again. And all going well, our hope is that in the coming weeks, we'll be able to show various short videos during the services to help all of us better understand what organic outreach is and what God's calling is for us as a church and as followers of Christ. So, let's just watch that video.
In natural ways, wherever they go in the flow of a normal day. And then let's add to that. Imagine if every home became a lighthouse. We talk about organic outreach for families. If every family, if every home, whether it's an apartment or a neighborhood or a trailer park or a retirement center, where you live becomes a shining light of the grace of Jesus. People are being prayed for, loved, cared for, and served, and the message of Christ is being shared in homes. But we go beyond that to the third level, the local church. Imagine if every local church became a mission statement, proclaiming Jesus, but also showing his presence and love, serving faithfully in their community, declaring the good news of Jesus. That's organic outreach, sharing faith naturally in our personal lives, in our homes and neighborhoods, and through the local church to the ends of the earth.
Repeat what he just said. This is what the foundation of organic outreach is. It's sharing our faith naturally in our personal lives, in our homes and neighborhoods, and through the local church to the ends of the earth. And in the next few weeks, we will explore some further practical steps and details of what this might entail. I'll now invite Erica to come up and speak about the marriage course.
Morning. Hey, there we go. Good morning. I'm Erica. This is Zach. You probably all know us. We're married. He said he was going to do actions.
Well, I have.
Good marriage. We're here to tell you about the marriage course again. You've probably heard about it and seen a couple of videos, but we just wanted to tell you a bit more about it because we've done it and we feel it was just so helpful. So at the moment, we have a marriage resource available to anyone in our church who wants to use it. It's called The Marriage of Your Dreams. Yes. It's presented by Paul David Tripp, and it is a series of four videos that are 45 minutes long, and they come with a study guide alongside. We've done it, and we've just found it so helpful and refreshing. We've been married almost 10 years, and we did...
Not quite, nearly.
We did a marriage course before we had kids, so that was a little while ago now, and this just came at a really good time for us. It's really well made. It's super engaging. Paul Tripp, if you've ever seen him speak or read any of his stuff, he's just so solid and gospel-centered. He's really funny, and he gives some good examples. So we'd just really love to encourage you to do it. It comes along with a study guide, and if you do use the marriage course, we'd highly recommend you use the study guide because it has some excellent questions in there to sit down afterwards and talk with each other about. So please have a look at it. Even if you think your marriage is, you know, going well, it could be better. And please don't avoid doing this because of fear of what others might think of you. It's just a really helpful thing, and we can all encourage each other to lovingly better our marriages. How do you get a hold of it? You email or contact Andrew in the office. He'll send you a link, and then through that link you have access to all four videos from the marriage course and the four parenting ones that Paul Tripp does as well, which we're keen to have a look at. One last thing about it, we're hoping to run it as a facilitated course, so that would probably look something like one night a week over 4 weeks here with a bunch of other couples watching the videos and then going off into your separate couple groups to discuss some of the material in the study guide and then coming back together and encouraging each other and probably eating something good too and just making it fun. So please consider it. I'd just like to ask you, like, why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you want to improve your marriage when there's this amazing free gospel-centered resource available to us? Now, we have a little video. We're really hoping it'll work. So thank you.
Everyone in this room has been disappointed in your marriage.
Parenting is a mission of grace.
Why would your lover ever make you cry? Why are there moments where you wonder if you married the right person? Where are the moments where you just want to give up?
Listen, there are many children and families of faith who are now teenagers who actually feel disadvantaged because they're in families of faith because they believe the good stuff is out there.
You don't struggle with marriage just because you married a less than perfect person.
We need to sell our teenagers on the gorgeous beauty of the plan of God.
What if I told you that it's possible to go places in your marriage you've never gone?
Moms and dads, when it comes to human sexuality, don't forsake your children. If they have a cell phone in their hands and they're 12 years old, what is available to them is shocking.
To experience a level of unity and understanding and love that you have not yet been experiencing.
You've got to open up these conversations. They've got to be ongoing. You got to be willing to step into awkward moments.
What you have in this passage is the marriage of everyone's dreams.
He wants to free your children. He is the great liberator.
A type of marriage that begins to defeat, liberate you from all of those selfish instincts and begins to grow you toward a brand new way of living made possible because God didn't leave you to your mess.
Just another announcement. Next Sunday, you are invited to fellowship at 5 that Pastor Bert Kuipers will lead in the cafe. It will be a time in the Word and in prayer and a time of sharing, and everyone is welcome. Just check the newsletter for more details. Next week, we hope to celebrate the Lord's Supper, and we should prepare ourselves for that. As Paul says, a man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. In this self-examination, each of us is faced with the following questions. Do I believe that my sins are forgiven only because my Lord sacrificed himself for me on the cross? And is it my sincere desire to love God and my neighbour and to serve them according to God's word? All who in answer to these questions seek their refuge in Jesus Christ alone are invited by the Lord to come with joyful praise to his table. Those who live in unbelief and sin will have to repent and seek forgiveness through our Lord Jesus Christ. Otherwise, they should not come to the table. I trust that with me you look forward to sharing in this special time of self-reflection and remembering Jesus' sacrifice for us. Now time for the Bible reading, and we are continuing through Colossians. Today's reading is from Colossians 1, 21 to 29. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body, through death, to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard, and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Now, I rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all of my energy Christ so powerfully works in me.
Hi everyone, and thanks Mosh. That was today's Mosh's first go at service leading, so pretty good job, I would say, Mosh. You're a real blessing to us. And my friends, as you can see, we're looking at some more verses from Colossians chapter 1. And it's very clear here that the central subject of this passage that we just read is the gospel. In verse 23, the Apostle Paul speaks of the hope held out in the gospel. And then he also says, this is the gospel that you heard. This passage is all about the amazing good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. It's about the message of our supreme Saviour. But as we look at the passage in more detail, what we discover is that there are, in fact, two distinct themes. For we read, first of all, of the enormous benefit of the gospel. But then we also read of the enormous cost of the gospel. And these two themes, they sit here side by side. And we need to keep them in tension. We should never consider one without the other. So we begin with the benefit of the gospel. And we're looking here at verses 21 to 23. And in these three important verses, Paul makes three important statements, starting with three important phrases. And the first is the phrase, once you. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. Congregation, I think we need to stop for a moment and to dwell on this verse and to feel its weight. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. This verse describes the situation that every single one of us was in. You see, my friends, there is a God who brought this world into being and who reigns over it and who controls every moment of history. He crafted us in our mother's wombs and determined the circumstances of our birth, the direction of our life, the time of our death, and also our final destination. He is a personal and a loving God who is the source of all being and of all good and of all blessing. But yet once we were alienated from Him, we were separated from the one true God, cut off, isolated, estranged. In fact, we were His enemies. There was not only distance between us, but there was antagonism, bitterness, and hostility. And all because of our evil behavior. God wasn't to blame for this, but we were, by our own pride and our immorality and our rebellion. We rejected our Creator and embraced sin in our lives. And as a result, we were going to receive that which we so foolishly strived for, God's judgment, His condemnation, and an eternity banished from His presence, an unthinkable fate of the most heinous proportions. Do you understand, my friends? This verse describes the ultimate negative reality that we were once in, and maybe some of us still are. But then comes verse 22, and the phrase, But now He has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death, to present you holy in His sight, without blemish and free from accusations. Once you had brought about the ultimate negative reality, but now He has brought about the ultimate positive reality. And so we feel that heavy burden of verse 21 lifting from our shoulders, lifting from our hearts and from our consciences. For the Lord our God, He has amazingly taken us from alienation to reconciliation. Even though we chose to be His enemies, the Lord in His grace chose to deal with our sin and with our guilt and with our shame. He chose to take us back, and He did that through the sacrifice of His own beloved Son. Because the Lord Jesus Christ, He was willing to come down from the glory of heaven and to be born into this world that He created, to be born in human flesh. And He experienced life upon this earth exactly as we do, except for sin. But then He also chose to give Himself for us. And so we took hold of His physical body, and we beat Him, and we mocked Him, and we crucified Him. But He did not resist, for He knew that as we carried out this appalling crime against Him, that He was in fact bearing the punishment of God that should have been ours. And thus, by His horrific suffering and His perfect sacrifice, we are now presented holy in the sight of our God, without blemish and free from accusation. My friends, we are not holy. We are not without blemish. We are not free from accusation. But yet in His mercy, God looks upon us as though we are, because He looks at us through the blood-stained cross and through the empty tomb. And as a result, He reconciles us to Himself. He promises to love us and to care for us every single day of our lives. And He promises that in the end, He will take us home to Himself in glory. But there's also another verse and another phrase. Once you were alienated from God, but now he has reconciled you. But only if you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. My friend, do you understand the precarious position you were in? And do you want to be reconciled to God? Do you want to experience his love and his forgiveness and his transforming grace in your life? Do you want to know his peace in your heart, the power of his Spirit in your existence, and his glorious hope for the future? Well, then put your faith in Jesus and all of this will be yours. That is his promise to us. You know, maybe you've never done that. Maybe you've never truly come to Jesus and thrown yourself upon his mercy and trusted in him alone for your salvation. If that's the case, then I ask you, what's stopping you? Confess your sin and discover the unspeakable joy of a restored relationship with your Maker. But maybe you have put your faith in Jesus. Then Paul says to us, continue in your faith, established and firm. It's just so important. So cling to Jesus with all that you've got, for he is the only one who can save us for eternal life. Paul says, do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. You might be tempted to drift away, tempted by the enticements and the riches of this world, tempted by other ideas and philosophies and religions. But I implore you, don't do it. Don't throw away what you've got. For my friends, this is the gospel of Jesus Christ, God's perfect solution for our deepest problem. This is the good news of our supreme Savior. And so I ask you this morning, is there any salvation more wonderful than ours? Is there any Savior more wonderful than Jesus? And is there any message more wonderful than the gospel? And so Paul adds, this is the gospel that you heard, that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. And it is in these words, my friends, that Paul transitions to the second theme of our passage. For you see, this wonderful gospel that Paul has so eloquently described, he says now that he has become its servant. And it's in that word servant that we get the first hint that while the gospel of Jesus comes with enormous benefit, that it also comes with a cost. For from this point onward, in verses 24 to 29, Paul describes the huge effect that it has had on his life. In verse 24, he speaks of what he is suffering for the people in Colossae, and also of how he is filling up in his flesh afflictions. In verse 25, he says he's become a servant not only of the gospel but of the church. And in verse 29, he says, to this end, I strenuously contend with all energy. I don't think we can doubt that the gospel, it had a huge effect on the life of the Apostle Paul. It came with enormous personal cost. We can read of his severe hardships in other places in the New Testament. And let's not forget that this man was even writing these very words while he was imprisoned for the sake of the gospel. But I wonder what that means for us. After all, Paul's talking here about himself. But do his words have application in our own lives? I mean, we love to focus on the blessings of the gospel, and so we should. But does it also come at a cost for you and for me? Are we not only its beneficiaries, but are we also its servants? Well, there are many passages that we could turn to, but let's just think for a moment about Luke chapter 14, where Jesus says this, if anyone comes after me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. And then he speaks of how a builder must consider the cost before constructing a tower, and how a king must consider the cost before going into battle. And then he adds, in the same way, those of you who do not give up everything you have cannot be my disciple. Those are extremely challenging words, aren't they? And we're not going to look at them in detail. You can do that later. Do it over coffee. Do it in your growth groups this week. But I just want to say that Jesus' message here is crystal clear. While the gospel has enormous benefit, it also comes at a cost to every single one of us. And so, like Paul, we too should consider ourselves its servants. But then the next question is, why is it that the gospel comes at such a price? Why does Paul say it involves suffering? Why does Jesus say it requires us to give up everything? Well, to understand this, we should first take a closer look at verse 24 of our text. It says there, "Now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church." These words tell us that our suffering is closely connected to Jesus' suffering. Just as he was willing to pay that price for us, so we should be willing to pay a price for him. But there's even more here, isn't there? Because Paul even says that in his own suffering, he is filling up in his own flesh. He is somehow completing or finishing off in his own life something that's still lacking, still required with regards to Christ's afflictions. But what could he mean by that? Surely Paul's not saying that the Jesus' suffering and death are somehow insufficient. Surely Paul's not saying that Jesus didn't do enough, and so we need to do more to finish off his work of salvation. Well, no, he's not saying that. Paul isn't speaking here about an incompleteness in the achievement of salvation, but rather he is speaking here about an incompleteness in the spread of salvation, in the spread of the gospel. For Jesus did all that was necessary for our salvation, but yet when he ascended into heaven, he said in Luke 24, "The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are my witnesses of these things." My friends, this is what Paul is talking about. He's not suffering because the gospel needs to be topped up, but he is suffering because the gospel needs to be communicated. For what good can it do if the message does not go out? No one will be saved unless they believe in Jesus. And how can they believe unless they hear about him? And how can they hear unless someone tells them? And that's what Paul is so determined to do. He says he's doing it for the sake of Christ's body, the church. But please don't think he's only talking here about being a witness within the four walls of the church among those who already believe. No, he's talking about being a witness in the world in order to grow the church. For that is what the church is meant to be. And that's where true sacrifice is required. And so we see this connection between the cost of the gospel and the spread of the gospel right throughout the passage. We saw it already in verse 23 when Paul said, "This is the gospel you heard and has been proclaimed, and of which I have become a servant." In verse 25 he says, "I've become its servant by the commission God gave me." What? Why? To present the word of God in all of its fullness. Verses 26 and 27 speak of the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but now is disclosed to the Lord's people. But not just to the Jews, But it says God has chosen to make it known among the Gentiles. He has chosen to make known the glorious riches of this mystery. And what is the mystery? It is Christ. It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And in verse 28, Paul says that he, that is Christ, is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom. And in verse 29, he says it's to that end that Paul himself is strenuously contending. My friends, this passage shows us very clearly that the good news of Jesus Christ, it is of enormous benefit to all who believe. But yet it equally shows us that that good news has a cost. And that cost is found in our calling to follow Jesus as his disciple, to be his witness, to proclaim his gospel and present God's word in all of its fullness, disclosing the mystery of Christ. And that forces me then to ask myself, and it forces you to ask yourself, am I truly a servant of the gospel? Am I suffering for the sake of the lost? Am I willing to fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions? The need to spread this good news so that the church will grow. I need to ask myself, am I striving to proclaim, admonish, and teach with all wisdom? And to that end, strenuously contending with all of my energy. And I think we have to admit, don't we, that in this matter we have a long way to go. But why is that? My friends, why do we so quickly embrace the benefit of the gospel, but yet can be so determined to avoid the cost? Well, I think one reason is because we still struggle to truly put God first in our lives. We're still far too in love with our own comfort, aren't we? Far too in love with the treasures and the pleasures of this earth. And so we have to wonder, are we actually carrying our cross and following Jesus? And I think another reason is because there are so many times when we conveniently ignore what's really at stake. My friends, people all around us are perishing. They're living without the Lord. They're living without purpose and without hope. And they're hurtling toward a godless eternity. But Paul tells us in verse 27 that we can show them Jesus, the hope of glory. And he tells us in verse 28 that as we do, we can then present them fully mature in Christ. My friends, this is our calling. This is our commission. To make and grow disciples of Jesus Christ. But do we really care? Caroline and I recently watched the movie Schindler's List. It's a true story about Oskar Schindler, a German Nazi and businessman who in World War II discovered that he could make a fortune by employing Polish Jews. But over time, he also discovered that by employing them, he could protect them from the Holocaust, where some 6 million of their countrymen were executed. To begin with, he only did this for his own benefit, so that he could make a lot of money. But over time, he came to love them. And eventually, he spent every cent he could to save as many lives as possible. And there's a scene near the end when the war is over, and he's saying farewell. And we're going to play that clip now. If it works. When I watch that scene, brothers and sisters, it makes me think about this man's deep love for these people and his determination to give everything to save them. And his intense sorrow that he could have done more. And maybe that will help us to think about ourselves. We have the opportunity, in fact, we have the calling from God to be his witnesses and save people, not only from physical death, but from being eternally lost. But do we love them enough? or are we more worried about feeling awkward? Are we willing to do whatever we can, or are we too concerned for ourselves? Are we willing to admit, my friends, that we could do so much more? My brothers and sisters in Christ, we have received the glorious blessings of the gospel. A salvation that we did not deserve, a loving relationship with the God who created us, and an eternity that is just too wonderful for words. But will we show our gratitude by also accepting the cost? Oh, my friends, let us never just be beneficiaries of the gospel, but let us be servants of the gospel, seeking every opportunity to be witnesses for Christ, both in the church and in the world. It's not easy, but there are two final truths in this passage that will help us. Remember in verse 24, Paul says there that he rejoices in what he is suffering. And that's because while the cost might be high, it's so worth it when you remember that God is using you to seek and to save the lost. And remember in verse 29, Paul says he strenuously contends with all the energy that Christ so powerfully works in him. You see, we're not doing this in our own strength. This is the Lord's work. He is the supreme Savior, and he will give us everything that we need. Let's pray. Almighty God and loving Heavenly Father, we want to give you our deepest thanks for the benefits of the gospel. Oh Lord, we realize that we, as Paul has said, were alienated from you by sin, by our own doing. But yet now we have been reconciled to you through the suffering and death of our Lord Jesus Christ, who came in your grace, who willingly gave himself so that we might live. And so, Father, we pray that you would help us to put our trust in him. Lord, please give faith to those who do not yet believe. And Lord, for those who do, strengthen our faith. May our faith be so strong that we can go on and accept the cost. Lord, forgive us for our unwillingness to serve and to suffer. Forgive us for keeping this wonderful news all to ourselves. Lord, we pray this morning, please work in our hearts, change us, convict us of our calling, stir us up, give us a deeper love for you, give us a deeper love for the lost. Father, may we contend for the gospel with all of our energy, the energy that you provide. Lord, may we proclaim this good news, and may we seek to make and grow disciples for your kingdom. Father, may we do this not for ourselves, but only ever for your glory and for your name. Father, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to give our musicians a moment to make it up to the stage, and then we're going to stand and sing together, "Go Forth in His Name."
Children, the fruit of his suffering, saved and redeemed by his blood. Called to be holy, a light to the nations, clothed with his power, filled with his love. Go forth in his name, proclaiming Jesus reigns. Now is the time for the church to arise and proclaim. to go make disciples. This is our course. This is our fight. Go, go, in His name proclaiming. Jesus reigns. Now is the time for the church to arise and proclaim Him. Jesus, Savior, Redeemer, and Lord. Listen, the wind of the Spirit is blowing. The end of the age is so near. Clouds in the earth and the heavens are shaking. Jesus, our Lord, soon shall appear. Church to arise and proclaim Him, Jesus, Savior, Redeemer, and Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is
We're now coming to the end of this service. Next we'll sing our last two songs, Blessed Assurance and Where Else Have We to Go. Just a reminder of the request that we exit the auditorium reasonably quickly to enable the 11 a.m. service to enter the congregation. If you have children in creche or Sunday school, please pick them up at the end of the last song. Remember that no tea or coffee will be served in the cafe after this service. You are, however, encouraged to take the opportunity to arrange to meet together in your homes after the service. Don't forget the offering box in the foyer if you have a cash donation that you would like to give towards the Vanderwells. Our parting blessing is from Romans 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Steadfast. Salvation.